The following is a 5-for-2 production.
Not adjust your television or your phone or tablet or streaming device. This really is a brand new episode of Ticket Stubs. We're back, Todd.
Yes, Kevin, I'm proud to announce I've had both shots, so I'm taking the mask off. So, yeah. So, after all these months, that feels good. Now again, I still wear it around the villages, you know, just to piss off the right wingers. But for the most part, I'm very happy that we're slowly coming back to normality. I hope the more people that get their shots, the safer we will all be. And the sooner we can get back to mass normalcy. So, speaking of which, someone saw some live music tonight, Kevin.
Well, I didn't see Watershed, but I did see the man on the t-shirt here.
God bless him.
That's right. I actually saw the first Colin Gow and League Bowlers show since last summer.
League Bowlers, too. It wasn't just Colin.
No. It was the full band.
Well, you throw the League Bowlers in, that's a whole nother league, you know.
New material in the set. I mean, it was great. But we'll get to that. Todd, it was a really interesting experience. So it was at Woodlands, where we usually go to the Christmas show for either Colin or, Watershed.
Great venue there in Columbus.
Awesome. So they had these plastic barriers between all the tables. So it's like it was almost like box, you know, like reserved boxes or something. Kind of interesting. They did say next month's show that shit's all gonna be gone. So that was already announced because, you know, June 2nd Ohio goes full bore, you know, yeehaw, let's open up and just, you know, take the masks off and just fucking
let's do it.
But it was great, Todd. Our buddy Andy, he's singing some new material. Andy Hyman, he sang a little Johnny Cash, Long Black Veil.
By the way, for those who don't know who Andy Hyman is, not only was he a longtime roadie for Watershed way, way back in the day, but
always
has been a long time working as a professional guitar and bass tech for the Goo Goo Dolls. So, you know, this guy ain't fucking around.
No, this guy's a pro. Definitely a pro. But usually, as you know, like, he always used to sing the Neil Young stuff, like, you know, some of the Ragged Glory material. But now, yeah, today, they whipped out a Johnny Cash song. He was singing the Long Black Veil. Colin told a Jim Steinman story, you know, all about the whole Watershed being discovered by Jim Steinman. And then they played 2 out of 3 Ain't Bad.
No kidding.
Yeah, no kidding. Colin was he was playing his acoustic guitar for quite a bit of the show. He's getting his inner troubadour on, you know. So it was full band.
I'm curious. Which version of the Steinman story did he tell? Or what part
just the same one he told here on our show last season on episode 25 about their friend having the Watershed demo and playing it and having it make it into, Jim Steinman's limo. So, yeah. So just that, you know, and then, you know, so it was fun. It was a good time. It was great to get back out. You should come up, Todd. They're going to do a matinee show once a month for the next 3 months. So.
And now who was playing on drums tonight?
Dave Massica is back on the drums. Former Watershed drummer.
God
bless him. He wasn't the original Watershed drummer, but he was with them for their pretty much, you know, the height of their, radio kind of popularity. So, but it was good to see him.
For those diehard Watershed fans out there, like I am, have no fear, folks, because Herb Shupp, the original drummer for Watershed, is still in the band.
Herb Shupp, who actually appeared, right? Who actually appeared on episode 24 last year. So again, you know, the Watershed guys. Maybe we need to get Dave Massica on the show. We've had Colin, we've had Herb, but no, I talked to Dave today. He's looking good. He sounded good. He seems
how's his back feeling?
He seemed to be very happy to be back in the band. So I don't know. I think we'll look forward to brighter days ahead. So
that's awesome. Hey, you know, the best is yet to come.
That's right. As the song says, exactly. So Todd, now, a lot of things to talk about today.
Do we have any video of the show that we might be able to share with the audience?
Yes, tonight? We do. We will have some songs here at the end of the show. We will have some material from Colin and the Bowlers. So you'll actually get to go to the show with us.
All right. Well, not to brag, but, you know, I've got my own Watershed ins, you know, and I've talked to Herb Shupp, the original drummer, recently, and they are moving on from Columbus, Ohio, and taking off out west. Herb's got a new gig out in California, which, you know, I'm very happy for him and Lori and the kids going with them. Both girls are graduating this weekend. You know, Sydney is graduating from Miami University. Mm-hmm. Go Sydney. Mm-hmm. And Chloe is graduating from high school this weekend. So God bless them both. Congratulations.
Yep, I saw the Facebook post. So
girl, sorry I didn't send a card. Uncle Bake is broke. So back next time around.
Ty, Dollar Store, Dollar General, Dollar Tree. You know,
they understand. They haven't gotten a card from me since they were two. And they didn't know they got one then. So, you know, really. But Herb and Lori know I love their kids. And so now, all right, speaking of concert season, now
looks like we're going to have a real concert season this year.
I got to tell you something. Now, I consider myself a pretty concert, worthy type of person. You know, I've seen, nearly 700 concerts in my lifetime. Kevin, on the other hand, has probably seen 700 in the last 5 years. So I bow to him when it comes to the number of concerts, maybe not the quality, but the number of concerts. Hey, look, you've seen enough strawberry festivals to have fucking herpes. I don't really know what that means. But
Zucchini Fest, that's my big one.
All right, so well, we can edit this shit out later, folks. That's what the hell was that? And Ticket Stubs, the fact that I have no control over this, and Kevin has the edit button. So let's start over. Kevin, considering I can only see pretty much one concert a month on my unemployment budget, you tell me what you've got lined up for the concert season this year.
Well, okay. Well, we kicked off, obviously, today with Colin Gal and the League Bowlers. Coming up here in July, Todd, we've got the you mentioned Strawberry Festival. We do actually have the Picktown Palooza.
Dude, everybody's got a Vegetable Fest, Zucchini Fest, Strawberry Fest. Doesn't fucking matter.
We're going to
some local Yahoo contest, and there's always Joan Jett or George Thorogood playing.
So we're going to be seeing Firehouse and Jack Russell's Great White. Now, you know, there's more than one Great White, so we had to, distinguish between the...
I assume the rest of them died in the fire. Sorry.
Well, this is outdoors, so I should probably be safe there. You know, they could probably even have fireworks.
Once blistered, twice fried.
Oh, God. I think that's a recycled joke from our episode G last season.
Hey, look, a good joke is no, come on now. Disney's on.
Okay, so coming up later in the year, I think I'm going to go see the Black Crowes do the Shake Your Money Maker in its entirety. That's like the thing about the pandemic. The Black Crowes, the two brothers, were able to actually remain friends because they didn't have to see each other.
They didn't have to see each other for the last year.
So after that, what do we? Oh, the Drive-By Truckers tour, Todd. 52 dates announced.
DBT, DBT.
Got five shows on the calendar before the end of the year, including on my anniversary, on my first winning anniversary. I'm going to be seeing the Drive-By Truckers in Asheville. So was actually looking.
It's a shame that I haven't seen you or your wifey since the big day, and I apologize for that. But, you know, hey, look, I sent a card. You got a candle from mom and dad. You got a birthday present coming before I hit the road. So I take care of you the best I can, buddy.
No, we love you.
So now, like I said, I can only, you know, with my limited, Democratic unemployment money, I can only do a show or two, like a month. So
you got anything you're looking forward to this year? Anything you, I know you, I mean, I'm leading you because I know you have tickets for Drive-By Truckers, obviously, some shows.
We'll get to that. But look, folks. For those of you bitching out there, oh, the fucking liberal Yankees just fucking living off the dime, drinking beer, smoking weed and cigarettes. Yeah, you're right. But I know that I'm going to go back to work pretty soon. And when I do, I will. But until then, motherfuckers, I'm going to have some fun. So we got in August, we got Cheap Trick with Rod Stewart. I've never seen Rod Stewart. Now, it depends on whether it's not, you know, if it's going to be like Rod the Mon from like, you know, the 60s, 70s faces Rod Stewart, I'm all in. If, you know, if it's like Downtown Train and every fucking, ballad that's ever made it on the AM channels, I'll leave early.
I haven't seen them. I was supposed to see that show last year. You know, it was canceled because of the pandemic. And I haven't looked.
It's rescheduled. That was a rescheduled one.
Okay, I need to look for that.
So September in Orlando, Judas Priest one last time with like four other fucking shitty metal bands I could care less about, like Mushroom Head and who the fuck knows. It doesn't even matter. I mean, like, I'm showing up about 9:30 and, and I'll take whatever I can get in the parking lot. October, right, Tampa. We got Alice Cooper with Ace Frehley, buddy. This is like back like 87. It's, you know,
that is totally a throwback, Todd, to episode C and to our first concert that you and I ever saw together.
I wish I was going to be in Columbus or in the area when he was in that, you know, there at the time.
Me too. I wish I could be in, but we will be with each other, in spirit.
Spiritually and emotionally.
And yeah, definitely. I think, I may have to, do some FaceTime or something that evening just so, we can, share the.
All right. So now that show is in Tampa, October, I think 11th or so.
Okay, I'm seeing it in Dayton.
Depending on whether or not the Republicans cut off that extra $300 a week, I may make it to Ohio in October for Drive-By Truckers. We'll see. If they keep this gravy train rolling through September, I'm going to Columbus, Cleveland, and Pittsburgh. Fuck
it. Nice. I'm doing that 3-night run. That's going to be my, that's going
to
be my
big. I would love to look. And if we're going to Mr. Smalls again, you're driving. Because, I got fucking lost for 2 hours trying to find those goddamn tunnels the last time. And either that or we're getting a hotel. One of the two.
Get in the hotel because we got to go to Pittsburgh and then to Cleveland the next day. I'm not coming all the way back to Columbus just to drive back to Cleveland the next day.
Shit. Let's get Dennis to meet us in Pittsburgh. He can pay for a ride for both of us to get back to Cleveland. So, we'll talk about that later. then, of course, now there's a possibility that Watershed may be playing in Columbus for New Year's Eve.
I kind of got the hint of that today from Mr. Massica too.
So. No guarantee, no promises, but if that's the case, then fuck my parents and family. I'm going to Columbus. I'm sorry, but I just saw him at spring break in March. I'll be here for Christmas night. I'm gonna get the fuck out of town. So, all right. So then of course, like 2 weeks later, we got the 4-day trip of DBT in Athens. And I'm in for that, so there's no questions asked.
Sadly, I'm out. Possibly between now and January, maybe something will happen and we can wind up there. But
now I hate to sound like a greedy scumfuck, but I did something I'm not really proud of. I bought tickets for the Brooklyn Bowl on Friday and Saturday night.
What's wrong with that?
Well, knowing they're gonna sell out, because now here's the whole thing. When tickets went on sale for pre-sale Wednesday night, right? Obviously, you know, I couldn't get in for Athens, but I looked just online for fun. Brooklyn Bowl tickets were selling for $200 after pre-sale on Wednesday. So for a $30 investment per ticket, I spent $150 for two tickets for Friday and two tickets for Saturday. Now, if they're selling for $200 a pop, and it were, you know, I'm going to subtract the fee you got to send to the goddamn ticket scumbags. So, but still though, if I'm spending $300 for four tickets and I can get $300 back for two of them, fuck it. That, you know, that pays for my two tickets and my plane fare. I'm going to New York, motherfuckers. So we'll see what happens. I you know, hate to sound like a bastard, you know, like I know how much I bitch about, you know, people ripping off, you know, others for tickets, but you know what? This, I'm not talking about Athens, I'm talking about New York. If these New York dumb motherfuckers would have paid $200 for my tickets, I paid for 30, fuck them. I'm taking that money and running, motherfuckers, and all I'm having fair, dinner on them.
All's so fair in love and war, man. Todd, I saw hotel rooms.
Is that bad karma? I don't care.
I don't know. I saw a hotel. Speaking of New York City, I saw hotel rooms today. A place called the Pod Hotel in New York City. Basically, you get a bunk bed in a hallway, a thin, you know, hallway of a room.
I was gonna say a pod is something you like put your shit in. You're hauling away.
Speaking of shit, your fucking toilet is in your shower, so it's kind of like a RV toilet shower.
Just with like a big hole in the bottom of the shower.
How much do you think this going for a night in New York City?
Do they at least give you a seat in the bathroom to sit on while you're taking the shit?
Yeah. The toilet itself is in the shower. So.
All right. I don't know. $2,000 per month.
No. That's I don't know per month. This is just a hotel. It's $200 per night for a bunk bed in the hallway.
So again, this is why I'm staying with a friend when I go see New York City, and I'm looking forward to that. Hopefully in November. Like I said, you know, I got it. Look, if I go to the Brooklyn Bowl for these shows, I'm doing some stand up while I'm there. I'm telling you that. You know, I've been in New York since 2008, and you know,
I may never go to New York City again. Both of my connections, one moved away and one passed away. So I have no more. You know,
well, no offense, My friend I'm staying with is nowhere near as funny as Jimmy, but then again, no one could be.
That's so right.
I wouldn't expect anyone to live up to those kind of expectations. but still, though, speaking of Jimmy, it is his widow's birthday.
Okay. So happy birthday, baby.
So if I'm going to be there, you know, I can hang out with Bambi and go out and have some drinks and have some fun, do some stand up and go see the drive-by truckers. That'd be a good weekend in New York if I can do it.
Yep. Like I said, I mentioned earlier, I'm going to be spending
speaking of birthdays, my sister's birthday is March 1st, which is immediately, you know, almost after the trucker shows in Homecoming. So that gives me about 6 weeks to save for Mardi Gras. so her birthday is the same day as Mardi Gras Day. So I will be in New Orleans for Mardi Gras on March 1st. And then my birthday is April 4th. Hopefully I'll be in Vegas for Aerosmith. Come nice. May, June, July, I got my 35th high school reunion. And then in July and August, my parents have their 50th anniversary. And they are taking me, my sister, her husband, and all three kids to Ireland for a week.
Wow, nice. Excellent.
So that's a pretty big trip.
Right on.
Now,
right
depending on how much cash I have left over or what I have saved from my unemployment money, if we're going to Ireland, screw it. I'm doing Europe. I want to see Amsterdam. I want to go to London for a couple of days. I want to see Rome. I want to see Paris. I want to go to Greece if I got the time. You know, go back to Spain. Fuck it. You know, who knows, folks? Look, the whole thing is,
I want to go to Switzerland sometime, see my family, the village my family came from.
Folks, life is very short. Now, I'm going to tell you a quick sad story. We'll get back to something else. I had a cousin, second cousin this week, who passed away at 53 years old. Massive heart attack. God bless you, Johnny. Hadn't talked to the guy in 10 years. But again, it just shows you, folks, that life is short. and you have to appreciate everything that you have while you have it, and tell the people that you appreciate when they're here. So please, you know, that's just my little piece of advice to you. Now, all right, moving on to a happy piece of news. Kevin, I found one of the most amazing songs on the radio the other day.
Okay.
And it's by this woman named Jessie Walker.
Okay.
I didn't know much about her. I heard it on the Underground Garage. And I love Underground Garage because they always play unique shit that you don't necessarily hear on general corporate radio. And Little Steven's got some great fucking taste. I wish he'd play some Watershed, but he's got some great fucking taste. So apparently Little Steven hired this woman as a backup singer, and he heard her voice and realized she deserved her own record. And there's this song, and I'm going to have you play it if we can find it. If I get permission from her, I got to talk to her about it. Mm-hmm. But so again, folks, Jessie Walker, and folks, the song is called What You Get Is What You See. And I think that's pretty appropriate for me, this kind of program. So just so happened, I liked the song so much that I looked it up on YouTube and found the video. And then I sent one to my sister and my mother and my dad and my cousins and my brothers. My
friends. Told me about her.
and I left a little message and said, hey, I just heard this song on Underground Garage and loved it. And she was nice enough to say, thank you. Wrote me back. And, you know, I said, well, you know, just out of curiosity, you want to be on our podcast? Why not ask, you know? She said, sure. So she has no idea who I am, but I mean, I've looked her up. She is talented, ladies and gentlemen. I'm telling you, this lady can sing. And she's, you know, she's sung backup for Lenny Kravitz and most recently with Little Steven. She's got her own band of her own. Very talented lady. And I'm hoping that, you know, maybe we can get her on the show. So Kevin,
she'll be this season's Colin Gow. She'll be that thread that we keep dangling out there, and maybe
we
like
might have a special guest. We might have a special guest. So Kevin, we're about 22 minutes at this point.
I didn't set the timer before, but
I need a cigarette break before we get in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, because this is going to be a rant.
All right, folks. Well, you're watching season 2 of Ticket Stubs. Probably a little more sporadic than last season, but you know, we're back, so that's the good thing. So we're still
airing the old ones, right, Kevin?
Oh yeah, they're still available. You know, we'll get into
if
all that.
If you haven't seen A to Z, catch up and then watch this one.
Yeah, we'll get into all that plug-in stuff, but we'll be back and enough time for Todd to go have a smoke.
I gotta go have a cigarette and smoke a bong. I'll be right back.
All
right. And we're back with more fun on Ticket Stubs. Rocky says, get me the fuck out of here.
Todd, you said we were going to have a guest. You didn't say it was just going to be Rocky. He's like a regular cast member. I mean, you know.
Well, look, you gotta tease the audience a little bit, so, you know. So,
all right, so Todd, before we get into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, I wanted to talk about... I want to talk about some rock books I've read recently.
Okay.
Read it, you know, the old saying, you read any good books recently, but...
Well, look, considering my book's not ready yet, we might as well read some others.
I want to talk about this one because it pertains, you know, somewhat to me and you. This is Nothing But a Good Time. We'll give these guys a plug. The Uncensored History of the 80s Hard Rock Explosion by Tom Bourgeois and Richard Beanstalk. What a
bourgeois. Wait, Tom Boudoir? Really?
Tom Bourgeois, like a bougie. I don't know if he's bougie or not. Okay, but
said boudoir.
Anyway, this a great book. I mean, look how thick this thing is. I mean, it's like a freaking Stephen King novel.
Mine's 300 pages. What are you talking about?
But, I mean, all the good dirt, you know, you want from the, you know, the 80s LA scene. And the New York, they kind of cover the East Coast as well. But the part I found very interesting. Now, we've talked about this, you know, amongst ourselves many times. We never on Ticket Stubs. But Alice Cooper used to always say that... I just got really, you know, fucking fucked up on alcohol.
He was a beer drinker. He was an all-American beer drinker.
That's right. You know, I just love to drink, and that was my vice.
He likes his whiskey.
Right.
Canadian whiskey.
Exactly. Well, then there was this documentary called Super Duper Alice Cooper, and
yeah,
he admitted that he actually was addicted at one time to cocaine.
Well, and which I find interesting because now here's my, I hate to interrupt, but now.
No, that's good. Yeah, I wanted to talk about this.
Who is one of the greatest producers of all time. And we referred back to this in our Jim Steinman story before, but even Jim Steinman would admit that, that Bob Ezrin was a great producer.
Oh, absolutely.
Now we know from reading Kiss books that by 76, Bob Ezrin was pretty heavy in the cocaine. Now you can't tell me that that he just kind of started right then and there and it hadn't built up from the years that he had been working with Alice Cooper from 69 to 75. No. So now maybe it's possible that Alice, you know, didn't indulge in cocaine in those years. Maybe it's possible, but I don't think it's realistic.
Now, all this to say that you and I have long suspected that Alice was much more than a heavy drinker, you know. Now, in this book, Kip Winger, who was Alice's bass player, you know, for the Nightmare Returns tour and the Constrictor album, he says in this book, I'm really surprised what I'm about to say has not made the rock news yet. I guess nobody reads three quarters of the way into the book. Kip Winger said that Alice was strung out on heroin. He said when he joined the band, Alice was really fucked up, and the whole point of everything was to bring Alice, you know, out of this stage of being curled up. He specifically says curled up in a fetal position in a hotel room in Paris, strung out on heroin.
Did you see what Alice looked like in the early 80s?
Yes, I did.
Man, I mean, I can believe this.
I can believe this, so... So anyway, we'll see if that gets around, you know. It has surprised me. This book's been out for months, and that's not, you know. Anyway, another book I want to talk about. They Just Seem a Little Weird. This is...
I want to read that one. That looks good.
Very good. Very good. How Kiss, Cheap Trick, Aerosmith, and Stars, with a Z, remade rock and roll. Now, I love Stars, but, you know, which one of these things is not like the other, you know? But very interesting story. I had never really honestly read a lot about Cheap Trick. So I don't know. Are there any good Cheap Trick bios? Did any of the guys in Cheap Trick?
Now, wait, was Stars one of the same bands that was managed by Bill O'Coin?
Yes. That's kind of a big part of the story about, like, you know, Bill O'Coin was splitting his loyalties and Kiss kind of...
That's where Bill O'Coin fucked up. He never, ever should have, like, taken the eye off the ball. You know, there are stories about boxes of checks sitting in storage somewhere, you know, that never got cashed for all that Kiss merchandise from the solo records. There was so much money coming in, they couldn't even cash those fucking checks.
crazy. But
anyhow,
yeah,
that's another story for another time.
And one last one. This is the book I'm currently reading because it's pretty cool. This is Take It Off, the Truly Unmasked, the story of the Kiss, the 80s albums without the makeup. So,
folks, this is the best part about Kevin reading books is when he's done, I get them. So that's, you know, they end up being Christmas presents, birthday presents, whatever. But,
I think Todd's hinting for this year's Christmas list, I believe, is what's going on here.
All right, well, let's get to this show.
All right, let's get down to the nitty gritty and snap it up. As a wise man once said, the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, Todd.
Rock and Roll Hall of Shame.
Every year, it's the same old thing.
It's getting more and more depressing every goddamn year. I haven't watched one of these episodes in three flipping years.
The last time I watched was Pearl Jam and the year Pearl Jam and Journey got in to get, you know, the same year. So there you go.
I might have watched that one. I, you know, just to see the little Filipino guy sing. But
Steve Perry watched him from the audience. That was really weird, you know. Steve Perry watched while the Filipino guy sang his song.
I thought Steve Perry was very gracious during his speech.
He absolutely was.
You know, and he showed much more class than Debbie Harry fucking did when her band just wanted to get up and play one fucking song, Debbie. One fucking song, you cool.
The drummer, he was begging. Was it the original drummer? Please, Debbie. He was like, I mean, he would have like pulled down her skirt and ate her pussy, I think, if fucking
embarrassing. Like, embarrassing. All right, bad. So moving on. All right.
To this year's.
About the ladies.
Okay.
Because now the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame for the last couple of years has been really adamant about getting more women nominated, more women, and you know, which I agree with. I you know, I'm not a misogynist. I'm not a Donald Trump fan. Sorry, Kevin. I had to throw it in there. But look, Pat Benatar deserves in. The fact one of the biggest is really embarrassing.
I think Pat Benatar is maybe the biggest snub in the entire Hall of Fame right now, currently. There's a right up there, definitely. Up there with like Bad Company. We can talk all about the snubs.
We will, and we will. All right, so now let's talk about who's getting in. Tina Turner and Carole King, both deserving artists. Ladies, absolutely, don't get me wrong, I am not shitting on either of these people whatsoever. However, they have been in before with guys, and that's the shitty part about it. They got not there, you know, Ike and Tina, and King and Goffin. So I get it. I understand that they deserve their own award. Right, however, again, couldn't they put one person in there who hasn't gotten an award yet?
I agree. I mean, it's just so crazy. There's so many people going in, you know, once, twice, you know, but Tina Turner does become the second woman inducted twice as a performer after Stevie Nicks. So.
I was going to say Stevie Nicks would be it.
Mm-hmm. Now, Todd, before
we got the Go-Go's.
Okay. Oh, okay. But I was going to say before we moved on to the next artist, have you ever, just to bring it around here, the Ticket Stubs, have you ever seen either Tina Turner or Carole King?
Tina Turner? Yeah. Hell
have
yeah.
You? Have you? Okay.
Fuck yeah. Put on a great show. And saw Lionel Richie open, motherfucker. And nice. He tore it up. He was dancing on the ceiling all night long, man. It was great.
I think we told this story in episode T, so I'll steer people back to that episode. Now we can move on to the Go-Go's.
The Go-Go's totally deserve it. One of the few all-girl bands who, you know, put themselves together, in the punk scene in L.A. in the 80s. Mm-hmm. Because there was nothing else going on for kids to do, and these little bitches got a band together, man. Right. They were not pretty. Look, Belinda Carlisle was not a pretty woman back in the early 80s. She was pudgy. She was not MTV ready.
She looks good today. She looks really good today.
She looks better now. She looked 30 years ago. What are you talking about? But it's because of plastic surgery. But when you got that kind of money, good for you. But
now, Jane Wyland was always cute. She was cute, you know, when she was playing.
And still is.
When she
still
was playing Joan of Arc and Bill and Ted, you know. I mean, come on, you know, very cute, very cute.
But again, they deserve it. Where the fuck are the Runaways? Where are the Runaways, man? I mean, look, I know Joan Jett's already in, but the Runaways.
So that would be another two timer. That would be another two timer.
Was one of the first all-girl rock and roll bands. They may have only had one hit, but goddamn, they tore it up in Japan. They played Budokan, same time Kiss and Cheap Trick were. I mean, they were contemporaries, man. You ask fucking Bunny Carlos, and Sandy West was one hell of a fucking drummer. So, you know, again, the Runaways deserve to be in. Now, then there's Todd Rundgren. Todd Rundgren has arguably three hits. And that's really all you need to get into the Rock and Roll of Fame. That's all you need. Three hits, a bang on your drum, Hello, It's Me, and there's two other fucking sappy ballads that you may hear on AM radio and recognize, but go, oh, that's Todd Rundgren? You know? So, anyhow. But now, he's done a lot of great production work. Fine, who gives a fuck? If you want to put producers in, where the fuck is Bob Ezrin? So You know, if you want to create a new category for Todd Rundgren, I wouldn't have a problem with that, but not necessarily deserving the Rock and Roll of Fame. Now, furthermore, this guy's a real asshole. You know, he's been nominated 3 times, and he claims that he doesn't care if he's in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame because he was so offended that the fan vote doesn't count as much as they might have intended it to be. Well, boo fucking who? Did you really think the fan count in the fucking Rock and Roll Hall of Fame meant a hill of piss? Are you kidding me? You know, so again, so if Todd Rundgren doesn't care if he gets in Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, fuck him. Put Ted Nugent in. Put him in Blue Oyster Cult. Boston. Fucking Meatloaf. You know, Jim Steinman.
I can't. I just can't let that just hang there in the air. Can you imagine a Ted Nugent speech, an induction speech by Ted at the Hall of Fame?
He'd have to have his guitar in hand while he did it.
Yeah, absolutely. Because every time someone would start to boo something political, he said, he just could wail the guitar right there. You go.
All right. So now let's move on to the big acts.
Okay.
We got the Foo Fighters. Look, you know, I love Dave Grohl. I love Taylor Hawkins. I think they're both fantastic musicians. I think they're great artists. I think they're true music lovers. And that's what I love about those two people is they really do. They love music. They've appreciated it all of their lives. That's why they've spent their lives, you know, doing this as a business. I admire them for it.
Their induction for Rush was amazing. That was
like, however, I think even Dave Grohl would admit Iron Maiden got fucked this year. So, you know, look, Dave, you know, you were going to get in anyhow. You're already in with Nirvana. Couldn't you wait another year and just let fucking Iron Maiden or Judas Priest get in? Jesus Christ. You know, I mean,
odds, what do you think the odds are on Foo Fighters playing a snippet of either an Iron Maiden and or a Judas Priest song when they're performing?
I think it might be the only point they can actually talk Ozzy Osbourne into getting up on stage with them. So, you know, this might be the only chance we can actually get a Sabbath reunion.
If Ozzy can walk and actually, you know, speak.
Dude,
Sharon
will wheel his fucking elderly ass out on stage.
Right. If I have a point here. If Ozzy is capable of actually coming out on stage and speaking at a microphone, he should be the guy that inducts Randy Rhoads. I mean,
if Ozzy could mumble the words more than no, then I'd let him do it. But I don't think it's possible. Now, all right, so now we'll get to Randy in a second because all right, now let's check out the early influences. 2 out of 3, I totally agree with. Gil Scott-Heron, God bless his brother. I mean, poet. Artist, spoken word. I mean, you know, combined jazz with rock, with politics. I mean, the brother might not show up for a show, but, you know, but at least, you know, he put out some great records. You know, so God bless him, and he deserves to be in. Charlie Patton. Now, for those who don't know, and I didn't, who Charlie Patton is, you can go back to the 1920s to look up this dude. In fact, he died in 34. Motherfucker's been dead almost 90 years, folks. All right, we could have waited another 10 to put this guy in. All right, it wouldn't have mattered. You know, we could have gotten 10 other artists in before Charlie Patton, and none of his family would have cared. So now the sad part is Kraftwerk. These motherfuckers, you know, these German pansy-ass techno candy sissies been nominated 6 times. They're like the Glenn Close of techno music. You know, I don't know how these perverts, still keep getting nominated every year. I don't know. It must be Kurt Loder. That's all I'm guessing. This is the only person I'm thinking still nominating this one. What about the goddamn fucking Neaters, folks? All right? There's not a fucking rap act in America that hasn't ripped off the Sissy Strut, okay? Where the fuck are the fucking Neaters? MC5's been nominated five times. Put them in. New York Dolls, for Christ's sake. First transgender rock and roll band. Come on.
That's right.
Ridiculous. Now, let's talk about musical excellence. All right. Now, again, two qualified nominees, inductees, and one who has no fucking place in being there. Billy Preston, God bless him, absolutely deserves in being in the musical excellence category. I mean, this motherfucker played on Sergeant Pepper's, all right? Dude, the Rolling Stones were looking to this guy to play on horns. I mean, he was a piano genius. He was a musical artist. Totally deserved to be in. Randy Rhoads. We've talked about Randy on many occasions. God bless Randy Rhoads.
Go over to What the Hell Was That and see Todd go to the Randy Rhoads crash site. We love Randy here.
Fucking problem. Randy Rhoads deserves to be in, but not this year. You know who should be in for musical excellence this year? Eddie Van Halen. Eddie Van Halen should have gotten a separate fucking award on the year of his death. No questions asked. There should have been a special fucking award for Eddie Van Halen. Randy Rhoads, we're going to save for next year on his 40th fucking anniversary of his death. Why do it now, you fucking morons?
We could induct Ozzy in the original Blizzard of Oz and then get Randy in on a legit, performer, basis. So
makes no goddamn sense.
Yeah, it makes no sense if they snub Iron Maiden and snub Judas Priest, but they make a special category to get Randy Rhoads in. It is kind of odd,
I got one last thing to say, and we got to talk about the rap.
Yeah, there's an elephant in the room. Well, we're talking about musical excellence, first of all, when you're talking
about
that.
How the hell does LL Cool J get a musical excellence award? Dude, what fucking instrument does LL Cool J play? Now, granted, the guy was one of the first.
That's what I was going to say. Yep. If we're going to accept the fact that hip hop is going to be part of the Hall of Fame, he deserves to be in there, I guess.
Dude, the motherfucker's been inducted six times and bumped every time. They gave him this bullshit because they know he's never going to get a goddamn Emmy.
The voters are going for him, man. It's crazy.
Look, so again, LL Cool J, they finally got him in there. They squeezed Kraftwerk in as well, So now, all right, the last and least deserving, J motherfucking Z. Now, I'm sorry, folks. I respect Jay-Z as a artist. I respect him as a salesperson. I respect him for the woman he's banging right now. But I do not respect him in the fact that he deserves to be in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. I'm sorry, folks. There are 99 other deserving artists, and this bitch ain't one. Look, Iron Maiden, Ted Nugent, Judas Priest, Ozzy Osbourne solo, Dio solo, Motorhead.
Honestly, in the...
On. And all I'm asking for is someone just put some chronological fucking attitude towards this thing.
I agree. Right? Even in the hip-hop realm, Todd, his biggest hit, the song you just referenced, 99 Problems, that's not even a Jay-Z song. It's a cover of an Ice-T song. Ice-T should be in there as a hip-hop legend before fucking Jay-Z.
You know what? Ice-T's a better actor, too. Fuck that shit.
Amen. I agree.
So now, folks, look, I hope that the rest of this program has not scared the shit out of Jesse Walker. Because, she's a really talented artist, and I'm really hoping that we can actually get her on the show.
It would be great.
See what happens. Jesse, if you're watching,
Hopefully she's doing some shows. Is she going to be doing some shows soon? You know, that would be the thing.
Well, hey, look, like I said, I might be up in New York in November. If she's there, I might be doing a stand-up comedy set while I'm there. But, you know, who knows? You know, this is how people meet. This is how things happen. I'm very excited. So,
right on. Well, Todd, it's good to be back talking about shows. I mean, the year is wide open ahead of us. So, I mean, I know we'll have lots to talk about. So,
well, I'll tell you what, buddy. There's a lot to be positive about. And I'm very thankful to have good friends and to have a healthy family and to be blessed with the opportunities to talk to the good folks here in America. So, folks, we'll be back with more fun on Ticket Stubs.
Can you dig it?
Muscle got serious traction.